Well, coming up, a serious topic, but an important one. Bullying isn't what it used to be. There are so many more ways for your child to be victimized, from social media to text messaging and more. So up next, the signs to look for, plus how to handle a bullying situation without causing more of a problem for your child. So important information. Welcome back, everyone. The start of the school year is always exciting, right? It's new, it's fresh, but it's also a time where parents should talk to their teens about some tough topics. It's a bit uncomfortable, maybe, and your teens probably won't want to hear it, but it is so important. So we have Mendi here, the CEO of Ignite Teen Treatment Center, and he's here with some great advice. Now, Mendi, thank you so much for coming in, first of all. And this is such an important topic that we're talking about, and something, bullying. How can we get ahead of this? Like, because bullying isn't what it used to be. There are many forms of it now.
Yeah, so you know, in our traditional 90s classic, the bully is a big guy, his name is maybe Biff, and he beats up on the kid with the pocket protector, he knocks him down, Biff licks his wounds, a couple people see it, pulls himself together, comes back the next day and faces, you know, the day.
Right.
Today, the bully doesn't have to be big, doesn't have to be strong, the individual doesn't have to be the nerd, there doesn't have to be any physical interaction. They can do something as simple as take a text and share that text and shame the kid, not just with the group that's around him, but through social media and the internet. They can shame him through multiple school groups. And then you have the added factor that, you know, when something's on the internet, right, it's there forever.
Right.
And so you have a sense of permanence, and you have a sense of being destroyed in a way that didn't exist before. These kids really feel like, I'm lost, there's no hope, this is a permanent forever thing.
Yeah.
And it's causing a ton of damage.
It's tough to be a kid anyways, but add social media to it. I mean, it's just so difficult. So what can parents do? What signs can we look for if our child is being bullied?
So it's very interesting. We have a red flag concept. And basically, if you look at different domains in your kid's life, you may see a series of flags. And not every flag means the world's coming to an end. But if the flags start to add up, you may have an issue. So for example, eating behaviors. If your child starts to eat less or eat more, or has, you know, there's some oddities in eating behavior. Sleeping patterns, having trouble sleeping, having trouble staying awake, having nightmares, social interaction. Are they pulling back more? Are they interacting more? Are they cutting off? Are they doing things on their own without us? School, right? They spend half their life in school. Are they failing? Are there grade issues? Are there troubles with peers? And a couple flags may not mean anything, but when they start to add up, you have to say, okay, we really need to look into what's going on here.
Right, it's more than, oh, they're just being a teen. It's
correct.
A combination of these things. So what can parents do? We know the signs. What can parents do to maybe prevent bullying?
So it's an interesting process, and parents don't always think about it this way, but I have sort of a four-prong approach, if you will.
Okay.
Number one, you need to communicate with the system around your teen, right? Your teen goes to school. That means outside of you, where you see them in the evening for however many hours that is, they've got coaches, and they have teachers, and they have mentors, and they have counselors, and they have other peers. You need to be able to connect with those people and with that system and understand what your teen's life looks like outside of your home environment.
Okay.
And it's important to connect with them so they know who you are, right? The teachers know who you are, the other parents know who you are, and you're part of the system, so you're tapped in, so you don't have to force your way in when there's an issue. You're part of it, right? The second piece is being transparent, right? When you decide to intervene on your teen's behalf, which is hard, right? Your teen doesn't want your help.
Right.
And you're afraid of, well, if I step in for them, what's gonna happen, how it's gonna damage them. When you're transparent from the beginning, your odds are a lot better. Hey, look, I'm gonna step in here. Here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna talk to your teacher. I'm not gonna do it for you, but I'm gonna do X, Y, Z. I'm not gonna do it behind your back.
Okay.
I respect you enough not to do it behind your back, but something's gonna have to happen here. This can't stay the way it is.
Okay.
The third thing is being supportive, right? Once you've taken the steps and you've alerted the school and you've engaged with the appropriate responses and the people you need to respond, then you take a step back and you support your teen through the process. You stand behind them and alongside them so that they can work through the process on their own, but knowing they can come back to you to bounce ideas, to get support. If they need help from an outside person, say a therapist or whatnot, they can lean on you for that.
And really quickly, your last, we only have a few seconds.
Absolutely. Last thing is hold people accountable.
Yes.
Hold schools accountable, hold parents accountable, hold other teens accountable. It's important to teach your kid and to teach a school in the system that we need to be responsible for what goes on. You can't turn a blind eye. You have to be part of the change.
Yes, and if kids are saying, oh, that's not my problem, teach them it is their problem to help and intervene. When
Absolutely.
Kids do that, hopefully they will do that as adults as well.
Exactly.
That's
Start
the goal.
From a young age. Make
Mendi,
the change.
Thank you so much. This is all really helpful advice. Kendall, over to you.